They just asked me to give you the 10 things that rock and roll has taught me. One, rock and roll has taught me and should teach everybody that it's actually about being a real person. And yes, you have your personas out there, folks, but it's actually about keeping your feet on the ground and being a real person. I'm going to give you an example. We had on the new album, I had Jack Black, Cara DeGuardia, Hugh Laurie. Now I'm going to give you an example of real people. They came by themselves. They actually drove themselves to the studio without anybody coming along. So that's an example of stars. Hugh Laurie, Jack Black, we're talking major players, real people. So if you're into rock and roll, try to be grateful. Try to be a real person. That's what it has taught me. Maybe I didn't start that way, but I'm ending that way. Another thing about rock and roll is the perception that it has to be rock and roll. See, rock and roll is not about music. Rock and roll is a state of mind. You can be rocked and sing opera. You can be rocked and sing jazz. You can be rocked and be a politician. It's about a state of mind. It's about a state of attempting to be an island to yourself and being true to yourself. Rock and roll is a state of mind. Rock and roll is about truth and nothing but the truth. I always consider my introduction, really real introduction into rock and roll and what it came from a band called the MC5 out of Detroit. And to me, that's about as rock and roll as you'll ever get. They were showmen. They understood the principle of, if you're going to buy tickets, if you're going to have somebody buy tickets to something, you give them a show. You don't just stand on stage and give me the argument, which I've had before. It's about the playing. Bullshit. It's not just about you standing up and making sure you can get the E flat 7 played correctly. It's about giving the audience something. About them, you giving them. And a perfect example is there's a fellow by the name of Eric Clapton. And yes, he doesn't jump around, he doesn't move around, but he gives you such emotion, and it all comes from inside. So it's not about posing, and it's not about standing there and saying, well, I sing great. It's about delivering the emotion of it. First time I was ever in the studio, 1967, I walked into a recording studio, and I was singing a song that I wrote, and I've only ever three times since then ventured into a studio with a song I wrote, and the song was "I'm an Animal," and we spelled it. I'm an A-N-I-M-A-L. I'm an animal. I can't remember the verses. That was the chorus, and we sang the verse, and I'm really loud, and I started to sing the chorus, which was "I'm a really loud." And the engineer, back in 67, I'm not sure how well studios are put together, but the whole studio, because I hit a note and it overloaded and blew a fuse, and the whole power went out in the studio. So that's always been the story of me blew out a studio. No, I just hit it. It was the engineer's fault because he had it up too loud and I hit a note and it overloaded the power system. Which was quite funny. I can't remember the first live gig, but I know where it was. We were playing, was in California, out in Huntington Beach, California, and we were playing every weekend at a place in Huntington Beach called The Cave. It was next door to a very famous place called The Golden Bear. The Golden Bear, I believe, is still there. The Cave is long gone. It's now a shopping mall or something. And one of the first bands, we were opening act, and they would have California bands mostly come in. But the first band that I remember that was really famous was a group called Vim, and they had a hit song called Gloria. The lead singer was a guy named Van Morrison. And so we were on stage, and I've always had this thing for theatrics. It's not something that is like put on, it's just me. And so I loaded up this, I wanted pyro. And so we figured out that if we went to this store and we bought this kind of gunpowder thing, that we could get this flash. And so they're in this solo, the bass player walked over, and and how we did it, we just dropped matches in, lit matches into this thing. Well, we did it wrong, we overloaded it wrong. Instead of getting a flash, we had smoke, there was smoke, and it just billowed out. And it's, the cave was in a basement, okay, thus the cave. And it, the club completely filled up with smoke. The people had to leave, the fire department came, and Van Morrison and them never got on. And so that's a rock and roll experience. Now, we didn't learn our lesson with that, right? There was a band called The Flock, 1968, in Saginaw, Michigan, in a place called Daniel's Den. We were still doing the same trick. We had gotten better at it. But this particular night, we figured out we never want to make smoke again. We overloaded it because we wanted this big flash. Well, it went off so much that one of them tipped over, and the fire, the Flock was a horn band, and it was like a Chicago, had a lot of horns, and the thing tipped over and shot a fireball. And they were set up for the show, we were able to get, but shot a fireball across all their horns, and they were out at dinner. So we finished our set, and we took all their horns and went into our dressing room, and they had that black soot like you'd see all over. And so we were down there thick with rags polishing this soot off. We probably didn't get it all off, but I'm sure they noticed something, but they never said, where did this come from? I think somebody told them, but they didn't give us a hard time. Now, see, you expect me to say the first time I was famous was when we were doing music, Bat Out of Hell. But the first time that I got recognized, that somebody actually came up to me and said, oh, I really enjoyed your performance, had nothing to do with music. I was doing As You Like It, Shakespeare play in Central Park. And I'm sitting at a restaurant on 72nd, right off of Columbus, called O'Neill's, and I'm eating, and somebody walked up to me and said, oh, excuse me, are you in As You Like It in Central Park? And I said, yes. They go, your performance was wonderful. So see, you thought it was going to be about rock and roll, and it's not. It was about doing Shakespeare. Come on, dude. First time I heard myself on the radio, 1971, when I was on Motown. You were on Motown? Yes, I was. And it was a duet, and it was a Stoney and Meatloaf. And we had just left the radio station promoting this single, What You See Is What You Get. And we're walking down the street, and a guy comes by. This is 1971, so you have to remember the old, if you can't, go look at the old movies. Guy comes by with what they used to call a ghetto blaster. And it was huge. The thing was massive. And they carried it on their shoulder, and when he passed by us, he had it on that radio station, and they were playing our song, What You See Is What You Get. So we chased him down and made him stop out on the street, and we said, can we just listen? So we listened, and I don't know if we ever said that's us or not. We just said we like this song, can we listen? He was cool, so we listened to it. He went on, we went on, and that's the first time I ever heard myself on the radio. So I was on Motown in 1971 when we were recording. I walked in one day, and we were doing this really awful song. Really awful. I mean, just terrible. Called Sunshine, Where's Heaven? And it was a... And so anyway, Stoney, though, who is named Cheryl Murphy, she loved the song. And because she had just had a little girl, she had a baby. So, and it was a... Sunshine was a little girl that died. And I just found it just sappy as everything. And she would sing it and cry. And so it was like, ugh. But anyway, the most interesting thing is we walked in and there was somebody finishing a session. And the somebody was Stevie Wonder. And he was working on an album called Inner Vision. And we walked in and I was listening to it and I was thinking, wow, I've heard anything like this. This is wild. And Russ Volvano was the producer, and Stevie was still hanging around, and Russ Volvano put up this track. There was no vocals on it yet. And Stevie Wonder said, oh, I really like that. Can I play piano? So Stevie Wonder, that's the only thing good about the track. Stevie Wonder's playing piano on Sunshine, Where's Heaven? And when have I ever been in a situation that I thought pretty much was ridiculous? Pretty much every day of my life. I wake up in the morning going, what the hell am I doing here? This is pretty much fucking ridiculous. And then I giggle and I think it's funny and I go on because I think that life is very funny. Except for when I get angry and I throw my toys out of my pram. Acting and music, I can sum this up in 100 words. in a couple of words. First of all, I just finished upstairs an interview that we were doing with Rob Cavallo. And Rob admitted that every time when I start a vocal, I'm completely unlike other singers. In the fact, other singers come in and they care about what the note is and about what the time is and about what the melodies are. And they figured, after a few times, they figured out that I really don't care about that initially. I care about what the character is saying. What is the emotion of that we're trying to capture? The notes, timing, and melody all are secondary to me. They mean nothing. They do at the end, obviously, but that's not what it starts with. So Rob and Doug the engineer, came up with this. Meatloaf is an actor who acts like he's singing. That pretty much wraps up about rock and roll. The only thing that I would say is that when on stage, I love pyro. Some people find it cheesy. I don't. The audience loves it. And the audience is the only thing that matters. So keep rocking, dude. Rock on. What else do they say? Don't ever stop rocking. Rock is a state of mind. You. And that about sums it up, kids.